graphs are data structure to store relationships. And so I think you can see that there's a lot of potential interaction and overlap between Gen AI and graphs. And, you know, in particular, there's opportunities for using graphs to help model context.
Welcome to another episode of Data Strategy Unraveled. I'm your host, Kendra Reed, Principal Data Strategy Tech Specialist here at AWS. And today we're going to be discussing Neptune and generative AI. And for those that are not familiar with Amazon Neptune, and you may be wondering, what is it, how it can be leveraged? We're going to get into that. And then those that do know Neptune, you may be also wondering, how does a graph database actually play a role when it comes to generative AI? So we're going to discuss that and more in today's episode. And as always, I have a guest here to really help us with this discussion. And so I want to introduce Brad. Hey, Brad, how you doing?
I'm doing great, Kunde. Thanks for having me.
Hey, happy to have you here. How about you tell us a little bit about what you do here at AWS and where you're joining us from in the country?
For sure. I'm joining you today from Seattle, Washington. There's a few of us Amazonians out here in Seattle. And I joined AWS almost 8 years ago. I previously ran and was the CEO of a small open source graph database company called BlazeGraph. And then myself and a few of my colleagues from BlazeGraph joined AWS. And a couple of years later, we launched what's now called Amazon Neptune, which is AWS's managed graph database service. Yeah. I'm also the general manager for Amazon TimeStream, which is our time series database service.
Okay. Okay, so you are definitely the guy we want to talk to today about this topic here. So how about first you kick it off with what is some introductory background information on what exactly Amazon Neptune is?
So graphs are a data structure, and graphs are awesome. And the reason that graphs are awesome is because they let customers use the relationships in their data to innovate and make discoveries and find things that you wouldn't be able to find without looking at the relationships. And so graph applications are any kinds of things that you build where you're traversing relationships, asking queries that have patterns of relationships, and you're using those relationships as first-class citizens in the graph data model. One of the reasons that graphs can be challenging is because graph processing is dominated by what we call sort of random data access. And so if you think about how you and I are connected, we might be connected through another person. And if I'm asking a question that traverses, you know, Brad's connected to Nicole and Nicole's connected to Kendra, the approaches that databases typically use to optimize that data access, they don't work well because you never know. It's hard to predict where in the data you'll have to access. Mm-hmm. And so for generalized graph processing, purpose-built graph databases can provide you the best performance to be able to build graph applications.
Okay. So Neptune really provides that capabilities there. And so you mentioned about the graph database capabilities, but there, I believe also Neptune has a concept of Amazon Neptune analytics. Can you tell us kind of what the difference is there when it comes to the analytics component?
Yeah, so at reInvent, which is AWS's big annual conference that I think a lot of you guys know, we announced Amazon Neptune Analytics. Amazon Neptune Analytics is an analytics graph database engine that does in-memory graph processing, and it's particularly good for use cases where you need to load large amounts of data quickly. You need to run graph algorithms, which are almost like little programs that iterate over your graph, and also to do very low latency queries where you want to keep almost all of your graph database in memory. Neptune Database is our other database engine, and it operates very much like a traditional OLTP database. So it separates storage and compute, so you can store graphs of up to 128 terabytes. You can do high throughput, low latency graph applications for selective kind of graph queries, typically 1 to 2 hops. And so we really feel like both of those engines give customers different options depending on their use case to build graph applications.
Wow. All right. So how does graph play a factor, or graph databases play a factor, when it comes to generative AI? How does that intertwine there?
Graphs and generative AI have a lot of things that are complementary. And, you know, one thing that if you think about what generative AI, large language models, foundational models do, is they use all of the things that they're trained on to help make predictions about how things are related. And we just talked about graphs are data structure to store relationships. And so I think you can see that there's a lot of potential interaction and overlap between Gen AI and graphs. And you know, in particular, there's opportunities for using graphs to help model context. And by that, I mean, you can use graphs. And one of the classic things that people do with graphs is they build something that can be called a knowledge graph. It also has other names, where they use a graph to represent things that you know. So you might say something like, Brad is a person, Brad works at Amazon, Brad is a general manager at a graph database service. And you can capture things and tell them explicitly what you know. And this is also known as explicit knowledge representation. On the other hand, LLMs can generate statements and answers from things that they've been trained on. So they can take things that they've been trained on and produce, you know, other predictions about it. And so sometimes you can combine that explicit knowledge about things that you know with what LLMs are producing to give you better results, produce generative AI applications faster, reduce hallucinations. And there's some really exciting emerging work in a concept called Graph RAG, where you can use generative AI applications for building retrieval augmented generation and use graphs as part of that to improve the precision and the quality of the responses that you're getting.
So it sounds like Neptune has a capability of vector searches, right? And so when would I want to really use that vector search capability there?
Yeah, so one of the first things that customers often think about with Gen AI applications is using vector search. And vectors obviously are embeddings. They can have a number of different dimensions. The type of foundational model you use is really what drives the dimensionality and the types of the embeddings. But what it allows you to do is vector search, sometimes also called semantic search, allows you to find things that may be related conceptually or related through this high dimensional projection that a LLM or a foundational model does, but you might not have related directly. So, it's an interesting way to find things that are related very quickly. Now, we think of the combination of graphs and vector search. We often call it a vector-guided navigation. And what the benefit of using graphs in conjunction with vector search is that the graph allows you to explain how things are related that have been suggested by the vector search. So think about vector and graph as explainability for similarity. You know, and an example might be, so we have one of our customers on Neptune Analytics is a large book sales company. And they have a challenge that they want to identify books that are fraudulent because the content has been AI generated. So they weren't actually produced by an author, but they were AI generated and someone listed them on the marketplace. Well, what they do is they start with traversing a graph about the types of books, and then they take an embedding that represents the aspects of that book, and then they find things that are similar to it based on a vector search. And then they go and look at the information related to the authors and people who published that book. And by combining that with this graph traversal about people who might have been involved in suspicious transaction or have some previous history of known fraud, they're able to use that vector search to suggest things and then use the graph to actually narrow it down based on things that we know have occurred based on previous enforcement actions. So it's a super cool example of this kind of explainability for similarity concept that I talked about earlier.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like we already are kind of on the bleeding edge when it comes to generative AI in general, but talking about this specific use case that you just mentioned here, wow, this is really next level here. So how are other customers leveraging these capabilities today within Neptune?
So, across the Neptune database and Neptune Analytics, we've seen a huge amount of interest in graph and Gen AI, and it admittedly is very early. You know, like our customers, we're really learning the best patterns and the best things that customers can use for. Some of the traditional things that are very popular graph use cases. So those include fraud. We talked a little bit about it. Knowledge graphs as a use case is very popular, and it's really gotten a lot of attention through the kind of the graph rag pieces that we talked about. You know, we have customers like NBC Universal who are using basically a combination of a knowledge graph about different content for their online television shows with capturing social engagement. And they use that, Neptune to perform for those kinds of things. We have a lot of interest in customers in the financial space for using a combinations of graph and vector search or graph and retrieval augmented generation for sort of the use cases fall in two categories. One is improving research. So helping to find things about companies that you might be non-obvious. And then also this kind of improving, know your customer kind of compliance type of use cases. So that's also a very interesting piece. And then another area that we have a lot of general graph usage in is the security use cases, and cloud security posture management is one in particular. Wiz, which is a large cloud security posture management company and one of the fastest growing startups over the last few years, uses Neptune, and they use it in a very interesting way, which is they use it for explainability of results. And so, I think we're really interested to see how customers like Wiz and others will combine generative AI with their security applications where they're already using graph for explainability to really help innovate and do new things for their customers.
Yeah. And I can imagine a lot of our viewers here are really interested in some of those use cases as well. And I can imagine they also are ready to get started with Neptune and how to use it. So can you give us some examples of the best ways to get started with Neptune analytics or just Neptune in general?
There's a couple of great ways. If you're coming at it from a Gen AI angle, Neptune has integrations with LangChain, which is a popular library for people to connect LLMs and generate queries. We also just recently released an integration with Llama Index, also a very popular open source library for people building RAG applications, and you can do graph RAG pieces with it as well. So those are two great ways to get started. Use those open source libraries and use the Neptune integrations. We also have Neptune notebooks. The graph notebook is something that we built and released in open source, and it has a bunch of different Python notebook examples for different use cases. So vector search, graph algorithms, fraud, identity resolution, knowledge graphs. If you want to get started very quickly with Neptune or another graph database for that matter, you can download the graph notebooks and those examples right there. You can get them up and running, and then you can start to tweak them and make them your own from that perspective. So those are fantastic ways for customers to get started.
Okay. Thanks so much, Brad, for joining us today and providing us with this wealth of information on what Neptune is, how it can be leveraged, and some use cases is actually being implemented with it and how we can get started using it. For all our viewers, be sure to check the description below to see a lot of those examples of how it can be leveraged and how you can get started using it within your own environment. In addition to also seeing more information around just data strategy, as well as all the other Data Strategy Unraveled videos that we have published thus far. And thanks again, Brad. And thank you to our viewers for watching. And we'll see you again soon in the next Data Strategy Unraveled episode.